Okay, so welcome to the Gaia Early Access Preview version 19.12. I just wanted to go through the interface with you guys just to start off, and then in a few other videos we'll go through some different methods to create some interesting kinds of terrains. So the interface is pretty simple, it's pretty straightforward right now. Some things are not currently available, but we'll go through that. So let's just start off with the real basics, such as new scene, of course, which will allow you to go ahead and create a brand new scene. Normally when you load it up, it'll ask you from the get-go if you want to create a layers-based or graph-based. We'll talk about that in a moment. We can open existing scenes, and of course we can save scenes. If you have not yet saved your scene, when you click this button, it will of course offer you the option of a dialogue box where you can choose the name and location where you want to save it. After you have saved it at least once, you are then put to using this button, which will add versions to it. So if I saved it as Cool Mountain, this button will then save it as Cool Mountain 001, and then 002, and so on and so forth. Otherwise, I believe this will just save over that same file, not asking you, of course, to save it under a different name again. If we go over here, we have our current build resolution for the preview window. If I go ahead and change that to say like a 1K instead of 512, you notice it goes ahead and rebuilds those things. This indicates two different features of the interface, such as the spinning yellow information that lets you know that that node specifically is being built. As well as down here, I'm gonna change this to 2K and just take a look down in this portion. And you'll see it's going and it's building mountain and then idle and then building displace, and it's letting you know what's going on, and the progress bar will fill in. I'll switch that back down to a 512. And we're going to take a look over here, and we have our navigation, which is better with a mouse than it is with a tablet currently. And part of that comes in with the need to use the wheel to kind of zoom in. If you want to orbit the camera, you have to hold down Alt, similar to say like Maya or other softwares, Unity, Unreal, etc. And you get navigation, sort of basic orbiting, and again the wheel. In this view mode, you do have the ability to use W and S to slide forwards and backwards. But if you want to use full-on navigation, you can switch down into this mode here, which is a first person view. So just kind of, I don't have to hold down any modifier keys, and I'm able to look around. And of course, then we have W forward, and then S backwards, and A to the left, D to the right, and then Q to go upwards, and E to go downwards. So this gives you sort of your basic first person navigation. Of course, we also have a 2D view, which is orthographic. We're kind of viewing it. It still has lighting in it, but you get to see the height information from the top view. Just switching back to this, I'm going to switch to some other view modes. So I'm going to switch to, this is kind of like a Lambert, and we have like a Fong or Blinn there, and then some that have textures kind of built into them. I'm just going to go ahead and get a little bit lower. Some of them look better than others. The obvious tiling pattern here is not as great looking, but it will look fairly decent on a distance. Others, the tiling is a little bit nicer, as a larger selection of texture. And then, of course, we have things like the sand dunes, where the repeat kind of makes sense and it integrates fairly nicely. And of course, we have a different kind of sand. And then, just going to switch back to this viewport, and we'll look at things like what look like matte caps in ZBrush, a sort of tune shaded view, normal mapping, and that's pretty much it. So we also have, of course, the lighting, which we can mess with just by clicking and dragging around. And the only way that I know to sort of reset it is to roughly drag it back to where it was. There isn't any kind of function that I'm aware of as yet to set it back to where you had it by default, but that may be coming in a future version. to the right of all these different materials, we have the ability to just sort of turn off the extra clutter in the scene. So all the additional buttons disappear and they can come back with that. Now that's useful if you want to take a screenshot. You don't want these extra things kind of hovering around, and you just want more of the image that you've created. We have, of course, the mode to allow you to refine information. So we have this ultra mode is the default, and that brings in a number of features to make it look better. But if I switch down to low, some of those things will shut off. And you see a subtle change, but it doesn't change a whole lot. This is primarily if you have, you know, issues with lagging when you're orbiting the scene. We can turn on atmosphere, which by default should be off. Sometimes it stays on its own when you load up, but when you click on that, that should give you your horizon. You can see that space there. And of course we have water, which we can take and adjust the water level. And this doesn't affect your map, this is just a preview, but it makes things look pretty, right? So you can have the little reflections, you look from these different angles, and we have the angle dependent translucency that fades off to the edge here. If you get down low enough, you'll be able to see the animated texture that's been applied to it. So it's all about making the interface look good so that you're viewing it in context and you get a better idea of what it is you're creating before you export this to, say, you know, your game engine or into a Maya or 3D Studio Max or Cinema 4D or whatever in order to create your environment in. So the beautification really helps you preview a lot of that. So we've got those things in, and there's some other features that we want to take a kind of look at. So my build resolution, if I go up, say, like 1K or something like that, I can, of course, export that using the save current, which will save the current build resolution, so it doesn't have to rebuild, it just saves the file, and that is really quite fast. But if you do want to go higher than, say, 2K, which is how far this one goes, you can switch over to here, and you'll have a 4K and 8K resolution available to you, which then, of course, you click on the build terrain button, which will then export that. You'll be prompted in those cases to save a terrain, and you can choose the format that you wish to use. Just go back to 1K here, maybe just 512. So things like textures unavailable, there's not much going on here, and even the export, there's a series of data maps that are forthcoming in future releases, ambient occlusion, normal maps, bump maps, biomes, and export of mesh. Those kind of things will be coming in future versions. Under the tools, we have some display options that you can mess around with, brightness, ambient, so on and so forth. Play with the atmosphere, haze, scatter, fog, all these things for the view once you have that actually turned on. So back over to the nodes. So each node, we can simply click on them, and if we wish to add things in between, so for example, I want to add, say, an auto levels to make this a little bit higher. This is a modifier, so these are our creators and some modifiers. I'll add that. And sometimes you just have to click and you'll see the update happen. And that's happened to this. And so it's inputted in between. If I had the display selected, of course, then it would add it after the displays. So in layer mode, it will connect them this way. In the cases of some other things like the combiner node, it will, if I click on this, it'll show up as red because it's not currently active. And in order for it to be active, I of course have to choose a source. So I can then choose from the other ones and it says, okay, well, I'll combine this, which was selected and already connected, and we'll combine it with the auto level or the mountain. Which one do you want to combine that with? And there'll be different methods by which you can combine that information. So you have things like the different blend modes, so blending, adding, screening, etc. And if you just click on that, you can use the arrow keys, and that will flip through the different versions, upwards and downwards, calculating each one of those. Of course, nothing's happening right now because I haven't connected it to anything else. We also have things like these sliders, and the sliders, it's better to click on them. So you just kind of click where you want to go. If you take them and drag them, it will continuously calculate for each little slice that you're dragging across. And in some cases that can be really intense and it won't be able to keep up with you. So it's better to just click rather than grabbing and dragging. So I know it's a big temptation. You go here, you see that thing highlight, says, oh, drag me. Ah. And you wanna do it, don't just resist the urge. Just click and it'll be good. Another option that you have to increment is, of course, right-clicking, where you can input a value, or you can use this nifty little interface, which will do things like set it to defaults, or you can set it to, you know, half the value, or decrease by 0.1, or 0.01, increase by 0.01, increase by 1, and, of course, double the value. So these allow you to quickly change with a little bit more precision. Some things that you may note, if you go away and you're doing something in another window and you come back, sometimes you won't be able to navigate. The easy way to fix that is simply just click on one of the nodes and that corrects it. So if you find the interface being unresponsive at any given point in time, simply just click on a node and you'll find that it will usually perk back up again. So that covers most of it, except for one key feature, which is the difference between, say, a layer mode and a graph mode. So if I go ahead and click on this here, I get a few options. There's hybrid, graph, etc. I know they're off the screen at the moment. The options are showing up off there, but I'm just going to go to the graph mode, and the graph mode will, of course, reveal the setup here. And so you see how it's connecting. So in graph mode, you can grab these things and these points can be selected and deleted. So just pressing the delete button, just as you can grab nodes and press delete, and that will get rid of them. You can do that here as well. So things like the auto level, I could just go ahead and delete that. It'll automatically reconnect things in there. You can also right click on things, where we have options to rename them, duplicate them, or of course refresh them in order to get them to function more appropriately. So the refresh here, for example, is not quite working. I'm just gonna go ahead and disconnect that and say drag and drop to reconnect it, and that has got it working once more. We can bypass things, and when you bypass them, what ends up happening is they kind of gray out, they no longer function, and other things further in the graph will. So we can go ahead and turn off that bypass, and then we have pinning it or deleting it. So a variety of options there. Inside the graph node, of course, you can right click and you can choose from there, or of course you can add nodes via this. However, once you're in the graph mode, and this current version anyways, it may not always connect them in the way that you expect if you try and use the add node while you're in a layer, in a graph-based setting. So you may have to kind of disconnect them, reconnect them yourself. Navigating in here is using control, and so control will kind of drag that space around. And that's the essentials of this, I guess. Right clicking on a node, you still have options there, the rename and delete as well. You have inputs, outputs, and masking features. And so if you bring in something like a height mask, you can say, okay, well, I want the height information from this. And that's going to give me height. And then I'll go ahead and say, okay, apply that height information as a mask to my displacement. And so what will happen here is that the displacement is not happening to the very top, right? Because the height doesn't go that far. So it lessens over that distance. So masking is a huge element in some of these terrain creations, and it's more effective to use masking If you are in a graph-based setting, then say in a layer-based setting. But more on that in a future video. So hopefully this has been overall informative, and I'll see you in the next video.